Is there any public comment to be brought before the commissioners? Is there any public comment to be brought before the commissioners? Hearing none. We will now move to the approval of minutes, beginning with the regular meeting of April 10, 2019.
I move to approve the minutes of the Board of Regional Commissioners' regular meeting of April 10, 2019.
Second.
Okay, any additions or corrections? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Okay, we'll now move on to general business, beginning with the fiscal year 2020 proposed county capital budget. Anyone here to speak to the capital budget?
I'll make the...
Yeah, okay.
I move to approve ordinance 19-03 fiscal year 2020 proposed county capital budget to authorize the county to purchase capital equipment and implement capital improvements for use in conducting the business of the county and to borrow money to pay as presented.
Second.
Okay. Moved and seconded. Any comment on this, commissioners?
No, but just to thank Jack and all the department heads for doing such a great job.
Okay. There's no comment. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Okay. Next is the amended proposed ordinance 19-02 establishing the Barnstable County Human Rights Advisory Board. I guess it's listed as the amended ordinance because it amends a previous ordinance. I put this on the agenda because there was a bit of discussion about it in the assembly. They decided to put off decision in 90 days. So this ordinance was actually sponsored by the commissioners and sent to the assembly. So I would just curious as to what our next, what our strategy would be on this, whether we want to withdraw it and without prejudice, as they say, and submit a new ordinance, or whether we should just allow the assembly to do their thing. Ron?
Yeah, I suggest, my understanding is they tabled it pending testimony to them by our county administrator at their meeting next week on the 1st.
Okay.
So my suggestion would be at this stage to do nothing. Let them hear what the comments and testimony from the county administrator regarding the matter, and then see what the assembly wants to do with it at that point.
Okay.
I'm just suggesting. I think it's a little premature to do anything whatsoever until they have the information from him that they want. Because we didn't have a meeting last week. Jack was on vacation, and it was just, the situation.
Well, I agree in a sense. I understand where you're coming from. The reason I put it on the agenda is because since we sponsored and submitted the ordinance, I thought, well, do we want to do anything? Do we want to change it? How do we feel about it?
I feel it's still in their hands because it's basically a continuing discussion at the assembly level, and I think out of respect for them, let them get the information they want, and if they don't want to do anything with it, if they ask us to withdraw it, we can certainly collaborate with them on that.
Yeah. Well, we haven't, as a board of commissioners, taken any action in terms of reviewing it. I see no reason why they can't review it for whatever they. What they need to do, and they can send that back to us because we have to.
Well, we passed it and sent it on to them,
yeah.
And they basically had some issues with it. I see there's a couple people here from the Human Rights Commission, and I'll take some with the indulgence of my board, take some brief comments on this. Does anybody wish to comment on this? First, Dave, identify yourself and. What
here or here, it doesn't matter.
I would go here.
All right. I'm Dave Schroffer. I am a commissioner, oddly enough, on the Human Rights Commission as it stands now. These microphones are really hot.
You won't be a commissioner too long. You'll be something else when this is
yes.
A delegate or something?
An advisory council, which is fine by all of us. So that we can come here and not have the same title that you do, and you've really worked for it. But in any case, as briefly as I can, we sent you a document from our chair that included all the kind of the timeline, so I believe you're up to speed on that. Major thing that I understand is that the 1902, which is what we're talking about, was initiated by the prior chair and also primarily written by the prior chair. And that has not met with much success. Your group did say we could go forward to the assembly, which we did. The assembly and a number of people who were very much in favor of the Human Rights Commission felt that it was inferior to the existing ordinance that keeps us in business. So it is our understanding that the existing ordinance is still active. It has never been withdrawn, and it won't be withdrawn unless 1902 is approved, because that has language that not only removes this one, but it also takes out 1506, which is the one that changed the status of the employee of the Human Rights Commission and made them reporting to the town administrator. So that, by the way that it is written, that goes too. However, because we knew we were going to lose that, we wrote it back in again. However, the document is simply inappropriate the way it's written, and to spend the time trying to fix that, to me, would be better spent with the minor touches that would be needed. If you want to change the name of it from a commission to an advisory council, we're all comfortable with that. There's other advisory councils within the county, so that's not a problem. So I, if you don't want me to actually read the letter, since you
all three, we've received it.
You've received it. Then what we're recommending is that you, primarily as Mr. Beatty has said, let the assembly do what they want to do. By the way, they did not give a 90-day. They gave it a no termination date.
Oh, okay. That's
so it is on forever. Their one thought that they expressed was that maybe it could be a part of the charter. But of course, it's already in the charter in terms of the basic statement that it makes about what the human rights are to the county. And this group is there to basically make that happen. So we'd like to be able to reconvene. We'd like to be able to hire a consultant. And that person would be an employee reporting to the administrator. And we would recognize that basically the roles change. That person was reporting to us. Now we report basically to them, so that the county has control over the activities. And I think it protects the county. County's one issue was, is there an insurance liability? Would we have a risk there? And the answer to that is not if it's done the way that would be perceived. And so we're comfortable with those kinds of changes, but we believe the existing ordinance is fine the way it is. Also with 1506, you need 1506, because that's not in the current one that we're operating under. And that if you choose to vote to either withdraw it, which would leave it entirely in their hands, so if they want to put it in the charter, they can do anything they want. They'd have no restrictions and not be bound by anything that you've already approved. So,
well, actually, it's in their hands now anyway.
It's been tabled with no. Yeah, I've never heard of this before.
I'm just trying to get the landscape.
I need to make an observation, just and not to, you know, get in any kind of engagement, but just a point of fact. At the meeting of a few weeks ago, when this was before us, you yourself and some other members of the Human Rights Commission were here, advocating that we pass it, and that's what we did, so that it would move forward. And I understand that also, you know, the reason for that was so that we could get on with things, hire the coordinator, so on and so forth. And then at the assembly meeting, it was almost reversed. So it's kind of a little confusing. So, you know, I understand there's some things that probably got to get ironed out, and that's perfectly fine. But you see where I'm coming with this? It kind of caused a little bit of a convoluted situation with it. You know, on the one hand, we were urged to pass it, which we did. And then on the other hand, now it's like stop. So that's why I'm saying let the assembly hear from the at least this is my take. Let them hear from the administrator, and then what the assembly, you know, see what the assembly wants to do with it. And if nothing, then we'll, if they want to start all over, then that's what we'll do.
But there's no objection to our being able to hire, being able to use the budget, and being able to function. What has happened?
That's up to the administrator at this stage. If that's what he wants to do, I would you know, whatever, go along with what he wants to do, you know, with how, if things can work out.
But I do want to say we've lost half the membership. Yeah. People are saying we can't do anything, we have no money, we have no coordinator, we can't touch a phone, we can't answer the phone for people calling in. There's nothing we can do.
We can handle that internally, as Mr. Beatty says. Yeah. Because the ordinance, I personally agree with you, and I think that it's pretty much clear that the original ordinance is in effect until it's withdrawn. Yeah.
Right.
And so we did recognize that in the budget, in the current fiscal year's budget. And so, you know, I personally, this began before I took office. I expected it, as others expected, to be a short process. Now it looks like it's going to be a longer process, so we may then have to move ahead, my personal opinion, move ahead on the intention of the original ordinance and get the commission up to speed. So that's
all right. And then with your understanding, we'll meet with the town accounting administrator and we'll work out hiring.
The doors are always open.
Yeah,
I can respond to that, Dan, because the chairman and I talked about it a little bit this morning. As he just said, we, as you know, thought that this would be done 3 months ago. And we were going to hire a coordinator based on the assumption that we had an ordinance that was fixed and in place, because recruiting people to positions like this is not easy.
I know.
And when there's a nebulous ordinance, it makes our job a little more difficult. However, given the fact that this could bog down a little bit in the assembly, I think it's time for us to move forward and at least get the ad out there as quickly as possible. And then we can talk about the process for hiring.
Very good. So we'll arrange a meeting with
you. Yeah, we'll try to get that out today.
Excellent. Thank you. Thank you, sir. Appreciate your putting this on the agenda.
Okay. Did I see another hand up? Dr. O'Malley is famous for his brief statements. So
Good morning. Brian O'Malley. I'm the Provincetown delegate to the Assembly. Just to, in essence, summarize a little bit of where we were. Commissioner Beatty is correct that there was not exactly, it was not a 90-day, although that was the figure we tossed around. We basically, the perspective of the Assembly was that there's language in this that was so unclear, and in particular, the process of how the successive commissioners or advisory board, whatever they're going to be called, are chosen. That's really not referenced in here, how that process evolves. So the feeling was that given the fact that we have existing four ordinances on this that are in place to guide us, we haven't overturned them, that there is no urgent pressure, and we resisted the temptation to bring this back in 2 weeks. And we talked informally about, yeah, let's give it 90 days or so, although we didn't actually set that. So I think the process here, the sense of the Assembly clearly was that we would recommend to the Board of Commissioners that you go ahead and proceed with trying to hire, and that the work that we need to do really concerns the biggest piece, since I think the lines of responsibility, that these are advisory board people, not directing the director. The biggest piece is really going to be how do we create this representative council to be their advisors. And you know, the mechanism had been town reps, one from each town. Clearly the problem there bogged down with the sense that nobody, they had trouble filling these positions. At the town level, these positions were kind of in a nebulous, who's responsible? They're not really part of town government. So the other mechanism that we used to use, and I would recommend it for your consideration, is to use the human rights, the Human Services Advisory Board, which is comprised of representatives of a whole diverse set of human services agencies on the Cape, as a sort of a nominating committee to you to present you with a slate. Ultimately, the new commissioners, the new advisory board, will be your choice, will be your appointment. But what we're looking for is, okay, what's the process that puts these names in front of you? It's not defined in any way. So that's kind of where we are.
Unless I'm mistaken, I think the Regional Human Rights Advisory Board is the mechanism that's used right now anyway in the existing ordinance for nominating. Am I correct?
That's correct.
The nominations for the Human Rights Commission actually come from the Human Rights Advisory Board.
That's right.
It's important to understand that once, as the previous speaker said, once an ordinance is passed, It will have language in it which will repeal the previous ordinances, so the mechanism for the structure of the Human Rights Commission and the mechanism for nominating and approving these will be the new, in other words, nothing will be grandfathered, it'll all be just...
That's right. If we create a sort of a omnibus, I don't know, you're right, yeah, it's enough, right.
So, two things.
A number of the current members, their appointments have either already expired or they're about to expire in June. That's one thing. So, and the second thing is the proposed or the amended ordinance pretty much calls for the new membership of the new board to be made up of members of the former board.
Current board.
So what I would suggest is, since things are a little bit in disarray, won't we request that the nominations from the existing mechanism move forward so that this doesn't become compounded, so that the existing members will be up to full strength, and then if and when this new ordinance kicks in, they'll be able to just transition into the new.
So you're suggesting we put on the agenda reauthorization of the existing membership?
Yeah.
Vote on it.
Yeah. That's because that's been hanging in the back and that's been compounding the problem. So
that's right.
That way they can at least function.
That's right. I think it becomes self-fulfilling.
Yeah.
As members disappear,
right,
the thing becomes less functional and they're feeling like they can't get anything
done. Right. And nothing's been, the appointments haven't been reauthorized.
Right.
This is, what are we on?
That's
like 4 or 5 months. So I think
appointments
at
a commission.
We should at least do that.
Yeah. Yes, exactly.
In the meantime.
We'll put that on the agenda.
Thank you. Okay.
Okay, thank you. All right, we got one more. Okay. Identify yourself.
Yeah, I'm Reverend Dr. Kate Epperly. I'm the vice chair of the Human Rights Commission. Sorry, I'm late. I went to the wrong location. I should have known you'd come up to this beautiful new facility, but I didn't. I just wanted to add a footnote to what Ron Beatty said. I think needing to move ahead with some new energy, some new commitment is important. We who are the five, the few and the faithful, really care about this cause, but we're exhausted from the minutiae and the processes which, God bless us as democracy, they need to be, but we have a new need to address hate rhetoric on the Cape, and we are planning a program. I've spent hours researching and getting resources for a program in the fall, which would basically, having talked to the Muslim and Jewish and Greek Orthodox and Council of Churches, would be a 3-hour Sunday afternoon program with people from the diversities of, and Jack and I have talked about it, and he said it's fine to partner with the Council of Churches as long as we're not furthering any religious point of view. We need a coordinator for that. I will do what I can. But that's just one example of how we need desperately to move ahead. And I think I speak certainly as someone who was the one doing the interviewing of our candidates when we were looking for coordinator and Jack's office stopped the process. We had 8 applicants, 4 withdrew after we made a choice and did not, the one we chose didn't take the job. And we had several others who were ready to go, and Jack stopped the process. And I just want to say that,
well,
Jack,
it wasn't
because,
just him. It was, it was a,
well,
decision.
Somebody.
Yeah,
anyway,
okay.
We had candidates sitting there. You need to know that between the resistance, and I will use that word benevolently, on the part of the county and the internal dynamics, which some of you have heard about, which preceded me on the Human Rights Commission, we got a reputation that, some people might say, well, I don't want to, as much as I care about that, I don't want to get involved. It's too much work. So what I would like to see from you all is support. And I mean visible in some way. If you will please attend our May, what is the date? Our academy is coming up with 150 high schoolers and middle schoolers there at the
Cape Cod Academy.
May 2nd? I'm not sure that's right.
Coming right up.
Yeah, it is.
A week
and
from tomorrow.
And again, normally we would have a coordinator create the program. We've done it ourselves now for the second time. And it is our star, our badge of honor. And we're still doing it. But please know that this has been a terribly wearing process, and our chair is not here because he works in Plymouth and he's got 12-hour days. And my great fear is that he'll quit and then it'll be on me, and I just don't know
enough. Let me make a suggestion, is that you contact those of you, contact your town representatives to the assembly,
yes,
including Dr. O'Malley and the others, and tell them that that you support them ultimately passing the ordinance, because it is up to them,
yes,
at this point right now.
Yes.
Okay, and also,
but I want you to know we don't have access to our database, and when Dr. O'Malley and others, Tom Ryan, came forward and said we knew nothing of this except when it was posted on the public service announcement, okay, we said, we're sorry, we can't get to our computer. So you understand the frustration. We can't communicate, we can't respond, and we're very tired.
When is this meeting on human rights, and you said you're going to have a meeting on hate speech, no place for hate speech. When is, any idea when that
is? We are doing it at the Cape Cod Community College, and we actually had it planned for May, but the rabbi is going to be out of town, his son graduates,
could
so
you,
it's going to be in the fall at the cafeteria in the community
could
college.
Could you come before the commissioners, before the meeting, and as a way of,
sure,
this is a way of communicating with the public, tell us exactly what you're going to do, and,
sure,
and so on, so.
But until we get a coordinator, the program probably can't be implemented because it's going to have a speaker and then listening groups and then several workshops. And that's beyond me as a volunteer to put together. So I'm just asking for support and not just problem solving, which we do have to do too. It's a morale issue at this point and a moral issue, because our hate language and hate behaviors are on the increase, mm-hmm, and we know this, and it's time to be present.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right. We will. So your motion is, you're going to make a motion to take no action at this point. Is that where you are?
Well, it only says for discussion.
To discuss. Okay. So we really don't.
Yeah, I have a question for Jack. Is there still a position for,
yes,
the human rights? There is.
There is.
It's
fully funded. It's funded for us this year and next.
Okay.
So.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Well, we will move along then, and we will have a discussion regarding the status of the Cape and Islands License Plate Fund. Ron, did you put this on?
Yeah, I'm on the County Economic Development Council, and this has been another matter that's been dragging on for a while. There's quite a lot of money on account, hundreds of thousands of dollars. Yeah, so anyway, I'm sorry.
Did you have a comment?
Yeah, I want to know, I went to the wrong building as well. Is there an opportunity for a public comment, a brief one?
On the Human Rights Commission?
No, just a public comment.
We had it.
Yeah, all right.
I understand. I'm a high schooler, so missing class is already stressful enough, especially I'm a senior.
Why don't we finish with this item agenda and maybe I can squeeze you in at the end, okay?
So anyway, the Economic Development Council is, among their various charges is to screen and take applications for the grant money that's accumulated through the Cape and Islands License Plate Fund. I believe there's some people here from the Cape Cod Commission that staff, that provide staffing for that. So if somebody could just give us an update on, with, we had a meeting yesterday, I think, Heather? Tell us how much, you know, what's on,
sure,
how much money is on account, what took place yesterday, and where we stand on that process. Because at some point, the commissioners have to approve the applicants,
right,
for the grant money.
And you're one of the applicants. The commission is an applicant to the EDC?
No.
Or is that approved in
advance? No. So we're staffing the Barstool County Economic Development Council. And as Mr. Beatty said, the council did meet yesterday. They're in the process right now of putting the Comprehensive Economic Development Strategy out for public comment. The goals and objectives contained in that economic development strategy will be complementary to the grant process. So once that project is approved in the June timeframe, we anticipate that grant round being initiated. As you know, Heather and Leslie were here a couple of months ago, and I believe you approved the grant framework at that time. So we're anticipating kicking off that process within the next month.
But what I mean to say is one of the grants is going to go to the commission. Is that how it works? No?
This is a separate grant fund through the license plate. So there were micro and major grants that we had discussed being able to put out to for the public. So it's typically nonprofits, government agencies that would be applying for these grants.
There's a pot of money that comes in from the license plate funds.
Right.
And the way the ordinance establishing the the EDC and negotiations with the Cape Cod Commission over the last couple of years is they get about 50%. It's done on a percentage basis. It's not a set dollar figure. I think they get about half of the money and put it towards the SEDS, the Comprehensive Economic Development. Is it study or strategy?
Strategy.
And help put that together in that whole process and implement it. So they do get some of the funds, and that's earmarked pretty much off the top. And then the remaining funds are earmarked for applications for both micro grants and larger grants, and that's what we approve. They do sort of still apply for their funds, but it's pretty much built
automatic,
in.
Going back, you know, 10 years when originally the commissioners decided to make a grant out of the EDC money to.
We still do to some extent. For example, the Route 6 rest area has been separate from that process, and it has been a point of contention in over the years. But it that's proven to be a necessity. So that this $40,000 was. Oh, she's smiling. That has already been earmarked and separated from the funds that are sitting there. But I think presently, after the funding for the Cape Cod Commission's SEDS program and the $40,000 for the Route 6 rest area have been set aside, I think there's a $350,000 approximately that's available now for grant applications, and it grows every quarter or so. So, anyway, I'm sorry.
Has the money been pretty consistent, or is it no? Is it up, down, back, what you know?
Well, I think it's a declining source of revenue, and it does vary a bit. It's down a little bit, but has sort of remained fairly consistent over the last few years.
Okay, good. I'll have to make sure I have. I used to have one. I don't know if I've still got it in my phone.
Keep up your license plate.
So my question is, do you have any ballpark time frame when these applicants that have been approved and will come before us
could apply? So we're anticipating that grant application would be available at the end of June. We're actually working on an online format to make it easier for people to apply for those grants. So however long the process takes from there, we don't anticipate it being a lengthy process.
So maybe by the fall it'll come before us?
I think that sounds reasonable.
Yeah, and there'll be some specific action items before the commissioners in the near future. The first piece is the creation of the grants contract subcommittee that's outlined in the ordinance for the BCEDC, Barnstable County Economic Development Council. So that will come before you at a upcoming meeting. The council voted yesterday to make recommendations for that subcommittee. And then, of course, the BCEDC will make a request to you for release of a share of the license plates funds for this grant process, and so that will happen in June as well.
June?
We'll be ready in June, yes. So we'll be ready to launch that.
We're waiting for it to come on the desk and we'll put it on the agenda.
Thank you.
Thank you. I guess you're done.
Great. One of the questions asked was how much is left in the account. It's just about $357,000.
$357,000.
And I do want to say about the money that the commission uses off the grant, the license plate fund. It's really an unheralded story. That money has leveraged so much additional money from federal grants, federal programs, state grants, state programs, that downtowns all across Cape Cod are seeing huge benefits because of this.
This is one of the stories I think that we don't get out enough, you know, as to what these people do to bring money here to the Cape. I mean, you know, we don't hate to toot our own horn, but eventually people have to know where their money's going. So we'll try to.
It's just
I know you try to promote it.
But, mm-hmm. you know. Yeah. It's a great story, and we should be talking about it more.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Now, discussion regarding the Board of Regional Commissioners meeting venue. We've been meeting here now for several weeks. It's quite a change from our previous meeting area. The room that we previously met in is about to be about to have the construction completed within
the ceiling.
Ceiling is not going to fall down on us. Yeah. So I just wondered what the desire of the board is. Sometimes I'm here. It's a beautiful, I mean, the county did a terrific job on this. you know, with the screens and so on. But sometimes I think I'm meeting in Fenway Park, you know, instead of some nice, and also the meeting room that we had was the seat of county government for 200 some odd years, so I just wondered what my fellow board members think about whether we should stay put or whether we should go back or...
Well, I, to be perfectly honest, favor our old digs.
Yeah.
I'm not comfortable here. It's large. It's the atmosphere, the ergonomics are not conducive for a small board like ours. I think it's perfect for the Cape Cod Commission board. I think it's perfect for the Assembly of Delegates, which are much larger bodies.
The MPO met here a couple of days ago.
The MPO. But I think that I'm comfortable, and for, you know, for X number of decades, the commissioners have met over there, and I think that it's more conducive for a board of three members, and we have ready access, the logistics over there for our meetings, for our staff. They're right there. It's easier for them, easier for us. It's somewhat of a burden to bring stuff over here, at least on my end, and I'm sure it is on their end. It's the technology here is good, but you know, again, for larger committees and boards. That's just my two cents.
Yeah, Jack, did you have what is? I know that if we had decided not to go back, you had other plans for that, or you had,
We did. We're here at the county. We're always pressed for office space, and we had plans to develop that into three offices. For instance, Steve Tebow finds a desk and borrows a laptop. Right now, he's homeless, pretty much. So we had ideas for that, which we can obviously amend. Your wishes are what we work with. I do want to update you on a few things, because we have the space that Janice currently occupies for the assembly. The plan is to move Janice over here, closer to the assembly room. But we can't start the work on that office until we do the roof here. And Donnie and I did a lot of research on cutting cost on that, because originally doing the roof and then adding the interior work, that was going to be a $130,000 project for one office, as opposed to putting three offices down in the commissioner's room, which is going to cost Donnie about $20,000. So we decided to be a little more holistic. We're looking at all the roofs, the three courthouses, all the flat roofs, this roof, and we're going to try to put solar film on to fix the roofs, so it won't cost the county any money, and then we can get back to relocating Janice in that room. To do that, we had to put out an RFP for a solar consultant, because it gets a lot more complex if you get into the solar world, and I think Elaine's about ready to publish that if she hasn't already.
You're considering putting her where the tobacco control
That's
is?
Right. Okay. Yep, and tobacco control will go down to the space that we originally constructed for Janice, right below us.
Yeah. In the basement?
Yeah, in the basement.
Oh, okay.
Well,
okay.
I think, you know, I actually am more comfortable where we were. I know that the county is going to putting out an RFP for people to look at the entire county organization, mm-hmm. you know, as far as the structure goes. And,
right.
and you know, after that, we can look at it again. You know, we can look at who goes where and what office space we need.
Yep.
But I just feel, not just from my personal standpoint, but I also feel for the public. I mean, I would like to recognize someone who wants to speak at the, you know, the end of the room, but I can't see them. You know, they're too far away. So
Well, that's why I wanted to bring up that point about moving Janice, because we can, when we do move Janice, we'll have that office space available okay. for Steve. So it's not doomsday.
When is the old commissioner's room available? You think is it? Can you?
It depends. This project, I checked with the contractor yesterday. He's halfway through.
You're talking about just the roof, but not to reconfigure the offices, but just
the lockup upstairs.
The ceiling.
The ceiling is done. The lights will go in next week, Donnie.
Yes.
The final lighting and the final cleanup would be next week.
Are they done upstairs? Put I guess what is it? A holding cell area that's
yeah.
what caused all this. Are they done with that?
No, they're halfway through.
So do they have to finish that before we can replace that ceiling?
The major work. The cells are pretty much in place upstairs, so there won't be any more dust coming down and descending upon us like a snowstorm.
So the new ceiling can be installed?
It's just about finished now. Just about finished. All we're waiting for is the lighting and the
Well, we haven't heard from our third commissioner here. What do you think?
Well, my thought about a meeting place is what works for the board and what works for the people who attend. That there's space, that people can hear, that it's pleasant, that it's not crowded, all of that. And this is huge. I mean, it's really a lot bigger than we need. I prefer a smaller space, and I always like the commissioner's meeting room. It has history. And I think that, you know, that's a big thing with me, is the history and how that worked. So I'd be very happy to go back to the other room if it were available.
Why do we get a motion?
It would be my preference over this.
And we've got some time yet before that would happen. So we can get a motion on that?
Not exactly. This was just for discussion. I don't know. Do we need a motion or?
Well, we're not going to move tomorrow, so no, we don't have
to. I move to... I don't think we need a motion.
No.
Well, I just want to make sure that Jack...
You want a consensus of the board?
Yeah, Jack doesn't go forward. In other words, he was presuming to go forward with reconfiguring that space, so I think he needs a sense of the board not to do that.
Okay, right. I move...
He gets it.
I move that the Board of Regional Commissioners meeting venue be solidified as its former meeting place in the Commissioner's Conference Room located in the Barnstable County Superior Courthouse.
Second.
Okay. No further. All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Okay. So
that's preference,
so,
number one. But number two, this...
That's right. If we anticipated 100 people, right, we could always have it here.
All right. Okay. So,
now we are on the proclamation... Cape Cod Law Day.
Oh, yes.
Somebody has
Wait a minute. Oh. Well.
You want to go back to, I moved, you want me to move, go back to public comment?
All right, go back to public
comment. I move that we go back to public comment on the agenda.
Mm-hmm.
You want to second that?
Second.
Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
Go ahead.
Thank you. Which microphone is best? This one?
That one.
Sorry, just one second. Let me pull it up. Okay. Hi, my name is Ben Niggle. I'm a senior at Nauset Regional High School. I live in Eastham, and I'll be a freshman next year studying political science at Harvard. I come today. I know you guys can't interact. I have to adjust the chair. But I want to talk briefly about freedom of speech. I know you all value freedom of speech, and a couple months ago we had an issue with freedom of speech. And during that time, when Commissioner Beatty made some comments regarding people of the gay community not being able to adequately represent their constituents,
I have to ask you to keep your comments general because, as you said, we cannot respond. I mean, within reason.
Within reason.
We can't respond. If you address any of us, you're not going to address you back. So it's just a formality.
Of course, Mr. Chairman. So I did tweet at Mr. Beatty asking him to resign, and I'll read it to you because I believe it was not rude at all. I said, at Ron Beatty Jr., resign please. Your homophobic comics do not represent Barnstable County. You're out of touch and it's time to go. And I was not the only one that day to get blocked on Twitter, so I know you can't respond to me, but I would appreciate as a student and as a voter, because I'll be turning 18 in August, that you unblock me on Twitter and you unblock others that don't agree with your views, because as a representative of the county, I think it's important that you do hear what we have to say. So again, it's totally up to you if you decide to unblock me. My handle is my name, at Benton Niggle, N-I-G-G-E-L. And like I said, I enjoy going through Twitter and hearing what people have to say, regardless if I agree with it or not. And I'm not one of those people that go on rants and start calling people out. But when I see some unjust or I see comments that I don't agree with that I just can't sit by and let go by, I will tweet back. So I want to be able to engage with you all, and I look forward to hopefully being unblocked on Twitter. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, now we move on to the proclamation.
Okay. I move to proclaim May 1st, 2019. Huh?
Did I miss something?
E.
Oh, the county's website. Sorry about that.
Oh, yes, 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 yes. No. On the...
discussion on...
Yeah, yeah, okay.
This, we've had this on before.
Yeah,
and,
he's right.
The
discussion
issue
regarding the adopting the county's... Yeah, there's no motion for it. But anyway, discussion on adopting the county's website is the official method of posting notices for meetings of the Board of Regional Commissioners. I don't have a motion.
For
discussion.
Right.
Yeah.
The issue was that sometimes the website would go down and that we would miss a 48-hour waiting period. However, I'm wondering if the physical posting of the notice on the bulletin board would cover us, even if that happened. You know what I'm saying? Is that, or we can only have one official.
Can only have one official.
We can only have one official.
One official.
You know,
you can. We put it on online anyway.
Anyway, yeah.
So, and it's on the board 24/7. So even if somebody is, I mean, if you want to change it,
Can I? Billy Travis wasn't available the last time we talked about this, and I asked Billy to come today, so that he could illustrate for you all the layers of redundancy we have in play. To prevent the kind of blackouts they had in Boston.
So before he even gets going, a week ago, I lost county internet access. So you're aware of it
from the county
office.
Campus
yeah.
here.
So that
apologies,
was,
my
that
voice
kind,
is
that gone. Kind of underscores what we were thinking, what the problem
it
was.
It does, and it it's actually completely separate though. In this case. In this case, we have
you
the website.
Speak a little closer.
Sorry,
I'm
getting over a pretty bit. Substantial cold here.
Is that even on? I don't know if that's
check,
on.
Check.
Yeah.
It's on. All right. Just lean into it, I suppose. So they're actually completely separate issues in this case. We have our website, public website, hosted externally with a hosting provider with 99.95% uptime, which is that's the limit on before they have to introduce financial remedies to their clients. So basically, if the county campus wasn't here, through something horrible happens, the website would go on. And that's about the size of it, really.
Can I ask you, does the county use the same vendor or source as the town of Barnstable as far as hosting their municipal website?
Not certain about that. There's a lot of providers out there.
The reason I ask is because the example that was used because of this problem was the town of Barnstable's website, where they do post their official meeting notices, and the attorney general's regulations for the open meeting law is if it's down for 4 hours or more, you have to cancel all the meetings and repost them for a whole another 48 hours. And that's exactly what the town of Barnstable had to do.
What
they had to do it because I'm the one that caught them.
4 hours is actually.
So I'm just worried. So for a, you know, from a productive standpoint, my worry is that could happen to the county. And with the existing system that we have, with it being on the board and also posting it online, my sense was that covers us for the public. Even if they couldn't see it online, they can physically see it, and we're covered from a legal standpoint.
I think from that regard, the website would still be technically more accessible than the physical posting because of transportation and whatnot, if that was the...
Right, but we put it on anyway, so it's kind of a moot point for my...
That's true. I mean, but I guess there's all I'm trying to do is allay any fears related to that. What people get into a lot, and we used to do this, we used to host our own websites through our own internet connection. So any event that happened locally with power outages or internet problems would result in a website outage. Okay. This is specifically the reason why we went external with it.
Well, I'm sort of a Luddite myself, and you know, if we need one official posting, there's nothing wrong with posting it on the bulletin board. In other words, once again, it'll be up on the website anyway, right? I mean, because the website has gone down for various reasons. I mean, we have storms on Cape Cod occasionally, you know, and everybody loses internet access. And even though it may be up on the website, you may not be able to get it. Now, I agree with what you're saying, is that they're not going to be able to get here to read it on the bulletin board. However, that covers us, whether they get here or not. But it doesn't cover us.
Which is what we're concerned about.
Yeah, it doesn't cover us if the internet goes down or people don't have internet access.
True.
And, you know, once again, I'm prejudiced because I only use the computer when I absolutely have to.
The Assembly of Delegates actually is, that's their official posting place, I noticed.
They do.
Yeah.
Jan wants to have
their hand raised.
I guess I could go on for 15 minutes with reasons why I
are?
Think it's a good
you
idea. But no, I guess what I would say
what's
is
your name?
Identify yourself.
Janice O'Connell, County
okay.
Clerk. There are so many things that we do that once they're done, you can't undo them. This, however, is not one. So what I would suggest is try it. To gain, sometimes you've got to take some risk. And if you try this and find that it's not successful or you have problems, you can undo it. You can revert back to bulletin board posting. I mean, I can stand here and tell you that somebody could break into the cabinet on Friday night, steal the posting, and have you posted the meeting. Needless to say, there are many, many organizations in the state now that are using the website as their official posting place. And it will eventually affect some of the things that our departments need to do that involve transparency and the public. For example, as county clerk, I'm trying to get everyone now on a system where they will eventually be able to go to the website, look to see what committee anybody is on, and whether or not they've completed all their obligations that allow them to participate on the committee. It's kind of tough when you're doing that and showcasing that as the greatest amount of transparency that you can have, but then on the other hand, you're not using that as the vehicle to post meetings that try to make the public aware, fully aware of everything that's going on. So I would encourage the county commissioners to try it, and if it doesn't work, undo it.
Okay, well, where are we in this process now?
Can I add one other thing? The other thing that we can't lose sight of is this only affects us, the county board of regional commissioners. Every single other county committee, board, or commission has to separately adopt whether they want to continue with being on the board or doing it online with on the website. It has to be done by each individual committee. The Cape Cod Commission has adopted online, but they do that on a completely separate basis as, you know, other county entities. So again, this doesn't cover every single committee.
I'm just wondering, we've taken a previous vote on this, and
yeah.
I can't remember whether we voted to adopt it and then we're going to look at it again.
No.
Or whether we have never changed the original.
I think we took no action.
Took no action.
And just to leave it the way it is, because basically is if it's not broke, why fix it?
Well,
why don't we, you know, if, we can review it again in a few months if we want to.
Yeah. Steve, you have a quick comment?
Just a quick comment. The Stephen Tebow, Assistant County Administrator. The only time we've ever had a problem with postings was during storms, and we actually weren't able to post it, so that would alleviate those issues. It's come up probably two times in my tenure here, but that was the only times that I've noticed anything with a posting where we physically couldn't get to the posting. On the board. It was during one of those blizzards, a couple times that happened. So that would alleviate that problem, just so you wouldn't have to worry about weather. And if Owen wasn't around or whatever, he could do it remotely. So that was just one quick point. That's the only time I remember anything like that happening.
That's a double-edged sword. If you have to post it online, and you don't have the whoever from whatever point or venue it's being posted from, if they lose internet access, they're not going to have the ability to upload it. So that's another issue. You see, technology is a wonderful thing, but it doesn't solve everything.
Yeah, well, I think we're ready to make a move on this after three,
okay.
After looking at it for three times. You know, I'm of two minds on this. I'm willing to go with the website, even though it has issues.
Okay.
And what about you, Mary Pat?
The website, absolutely.
Okay, so. I move. You know, move that we stay go with the website.
So you want to change it to online posting?
Online.
Yes.
Okay.
That would be my motion.
Okay, I'll second that. Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 It's unanimous after all that. Okay. Now we get to the proclamation.
Okay, we're on F, right? I move, we all set? I move to proclaim May 1st, 2019, Cape Cod as Law Day in Barnstable County as presented.
Second.
And we have a, this is a little bit of background. This is a national event, and the Barnstable County Bar Association is sponsoring the local event on May 1st, which is being held over at the Barnstable County District Courthouse. And I thought it would be nice for us to help them out with this. Is it okay if I read the proclamation?
Sure.
Whereas Law Day is, quote, day of national dedication to the principles of government under law, unquote, as stated by President Dwight Eisenhower, who established the first nationwide commemoration in 1958, and whereas the First Amendment to the U.S. Constitution states, quote, Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof or abridging the freedom of speech or of the press or the right of the people peaceably to assemble and to petition the government for a redress of grievances, and whereas the 14th Amendment incorporates the rights established in the First Amendment to apply to state governments, and whereas the Universal Declaration of Human Rights states, quote, everyone has the right to freedom of opinion and expression. This right includes freedom to hold opinions without interference and to seek, receive, and impart information and ideas, though through any media and regardless of frontiers, unquote. And whereas the 2019 Law Day theme enables us to reflect on the way that freedom of speech and freedom of the press provide the foundation for our free society, now therefore we, the Board of Regional Commissioners of Barnstable County, do hereby proclaim Wednesday, May 1st, 2019 as Law Day. We urge the citizens, schools, businesses, and media of Barnstable County to use this occasion to preserve and strengthen the rule of law. In witness thereof, we hereunto set our hands this 24th day of April in the year 2019 and of the independence of the United States of America, the 243rd year.
It will be signed by us.
It'll be signed by Ronald Bergstrom's chair, Mary Pat Flynn, vice chair, and Ronald Beatty, commissioner.
Okay. Okay. Is there any new business to be brought?
Wait a second. You still we have two representatives from the Bar Association. Would you like to come up and say anything, or you? We'd like to give you this proclamation after we sign it.
No.
Okay. Thank you for coming.
Thank you. Okay. Is there any new business? Report before the chair and the board. Hearing none, we will now go into commissioner's actions, and we will ask for approval of the actions as listed in the warrant.
Okay. I move to approve commissioner's actions as listed on the agenda, items 8A, 8B, 8C, 8D, 8E, 8F, 8G, and 8H as presented.
Second.
Okay, moved and second. Any further comments? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Okay, I have nothing to report. Mayor Pat?
No.
Beatty?
No.
Okay, then there's one other item to be, anything for you, Jack?
Just a few things. We met yesterday with the delegation, the Cape Cod Chamber of Commerce, the Yarmouth Chamber of Commerce, representatives from the towns of Barnstable and Yarmouth on the Route 6 rest area, and we had a very, very positive meeting. We've been asked, meaning the Yarmouth Chamber of Commerce and the county, to put together a proposal for a pilot project that would allow food trucks to serve the public and help defray some of the costs that we encountered in keeping that rest area open, and to get it to DOT as soon as possible so that we could possibly have an approval by Memorial Day weekend. So we'll keep you in the loop on that.
Memorial Day weekend is a month away.
That's right.
It's lightning speed.
Yeah, they were very favorable.
Okay.
I want to say this is the 24th year that we have been working on this project.
Yes. Thank you.
I came here in 1993, yeah. I think, and that was the big issue. Sorry, I had to mention that.
I know. So maybe a month from now it'll all be over.
The second thing is the Fire Training Academy. Obviously, with the change in the regulations that DEP has proposed, There's going to be significant changes in the environmental regulations relative to Cape Cod. To get ahead of the curve, we've had a number of meetings with the base, and we continue to do so. So I just don't want you to hear that background. It's still in the early stage discussions, but it is ongoing, and it's pretty aggressive. So the possibility that we would be relocating the Fire Training Academy before the end of the year is alive. Next thing I want to just briefly touch on, and I don't want any action or even maybe even discussion today, because it's very unusual. Dealing with the shock issue is going to become a complex issue. There is no solution except to keep the public honestly advised of what the risks are. The Chamber of Commerce has engaged a media and marketing firm, and they are looking for contributions from some of the various communities, as well as the county and businesses, of course, to pay for this media and messaging marketing campaign. I will try to get some information to you, and then we can think about whether or not we have the funds to add a little bit. They're not asking for much.
Would they be eligible for EDC grants?
Yeah, they would be. Yeah, they would be. That's a great point.
Wait a minute. The Chamber of Commerce is doing that?
Yes. Yeah.
That's tricky. The license plate.
They already get money.
They already get a large amount. The two recipients of license plate funds are the Chamber of Commerce and the County Commissioners, and so they already get theirs.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. Just trying to find a way. Yeah.
So anyway, we don't need to discuss it today because I don't have any writing that you can look at. But I just want you to know that was out there. And finally, next door, right now, we're having a gathering of our retirees, so we'd like you to join us. We have plaques for you to distribute to our 20 retirees that have taken advantage of the early retirement program.
Thank you. Okay, there's one more item on the agenda. It's item number 11.
I move to adjourn.
Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? How many of these do we have?